Welcome to another one of my World War II history walks. I'm at Bewley Road train station. You're probably wondering, why am I at a train station? Actually, it's a good question because it has absolutely nothing to do with World War II. But I just wanted to come here quickly because there is an interesting fact about it. In 1847, when the rail company wanted to seek permission to cross Baron Montague's estate, he said the only reason he'd let them put this rail line down here would be if they built him his own private railway station. And that's what this is. It's his own private railway station. Or it was. He's not alive now, obviously. But interestingly as well, it's the least used train station in the whole of Hampshire. Only 25 people a day on average use it. So, yeah, I think Baron Montague definitely got the better end of the deal there. However, this is a good place to start because we're going to be looking at some World War II history down here today. And also this place here, kind of interesting. I'll explain what that is later on. But to start with, we're going to be walking down this road. So I've just walked past the Drift Inn, down from the Bewley Road train station there, just coming up to Shatterford Bottom. You can see the entrance here to this site where the horses stood. In fact, there's lots of horses out today. It's really good to see. I'm going to give that horse a slightly wider berth than normal because we're next to a road. But as we come into Shatterford Bottom here, you can see this track. It doesn't really go anywhere. But what this was, next to the Drift Inn there, this was Shatterford Bottom military depot. So during World War II, as I'm sure you're aware, the whole of the New Forest was effectively like a huge campsite. There were training areas where the troops would train before they went off to war. There was also, obviously, a big hub in the lead up to D-Day, before the embarkation, a lot of which happened from Leap Beach, not too far from here. But this area, so it was a storage depot. And if you look at aerial photography from the time, you can clearly see Nissen huts, storage areas. There was so much here, but you wouldn't know it today unless you take a closer look. That's what I'm gonna do now. So I'm gonna do a bit of a loop around, see if we see anything that gives just a tiny hint as to what life might have been like during World War II here. So the first thing I'm starting to notice are some ditches that run up here. So you can see there's one ditch that goes that way and then another ditch here. Now, having looking at that aerial photography, in effect, this is one of the tracks that would run through the storage depot. So I would hazard a guess that the trucks would come down the main track here, then turn off, go down one of these tracks, and they could either pick up what they needed to pick up or drop off what they needed to drop off. And I've already started to see some evidence of where some temporary buildings might have been as well. Not any, no real great examples yet. So as I say, gonna carry on round. Let's just see what we see. This is certainly one of my favorite walks at the moment. I think because it's just so peaceful. You don't really get anyone else here. So if you like a little bit of solitude, it's definitely a place to check out, particularly with the elements of World War II history here as well. What I love about these kind of walks is the fact that you're stepping in history, right? And at some point, this was an utter hive of activity that we can start to see now, the brickwork in the ground. And it's, I think if we come over to this ditch, you can see evidence of where there was tarmacking at some point. So yeah, to the casual observer, they might just think some concrete's been dumped here or some tarmac, who knows? But to people who like their World War II history, it takes on an entire new dimension. And you just think, what was going on here? I nearly finished the loop now of Shatterford Bottom Military Depot. As you can see, it's quite a wide expanse of land. Where those tall trees are in the background, that's just the pub. So you can get an idea of the scale, along with the maps that I'll overlay as well. But just as I was leaving, saw something else in the ground. Evidently, some kind of plate that served some purpose when this was a military depot. So yeah, I mean, when I'm here, I just like to think that all the preparation that was going on here is crazy. Anyway, what we're gonna do next is head on down the road. I'm gonna go that way, and I'll show you why in a minute. where I'm aiming to get to is just over this hill here. There should be, a second World War bomb crater. So nearly there. This over here, now we're in the middle of nowhere. This is alleged to be a World War II bomb crater. Doesn't look like much, and to the untrained eye, you probably wouldn't think much of this. It's really just a smelly old pond, isn't it? But if you want to have some interesting World War II heritage walks yourself out in the New Forest, what I recommend you do is have a look at the nfknowledge.org website, because on there's a map. It's very interactive, and you can overlay different types of maps, one of which shows you what the archaeologists from the New Forest National Park believe to be bomb craters, and that one over there is actually one of them. So one ticks off the list. What I'm going to do now is, as you can see up on the hill there's a group of trees. It's another really peaceful place to take in on this walk if you want to sit down and have a quick drink. Going to go up there and then go over the road, because there's another World War II site up there. So let's go see what we find. I'm just approaching the trees now, up ahead. I love this part of the walk because you get so much solitude, and I'm probably beginning to sound like someone who just likes being by themselves, but I think that's what the pandemic does to you, isn't it? But either way, it's good for the soul just to come out here. And there's always this juxtaposition that I feel when I'm out in the forest, particularly when I've got this World War II discovery mindset on. Just how different it would have been in the 1940s particularly, because the New Forest was critically important. As I mentioned earlier, in the lead up to D-Day, there were troops stationed in these woods, maybe some were even here tented up, ready to go. So you can just imagine how busy in effect it must have been. And then when you add on the fact that there were 12 airfields, it just goes to show how busy this place must have been. And then when you see the amount of bomb craters around here, I'll show you a couple more in a minute and give you my view, my guess on why there's so many on this piece of land. As you can see, there's a pan across. There you go. That's the drift in over there. And then as you move across this way, over in the distance there, will be the yew tree anti-aircraft position, which is where we're going to try and get to today as well. But I'm just going to spend a few minutes here because it's good for my soul, like I said. Now back on the side of the road, heading away from Bewley Road train station, which we left a long time behind us now. The reason I'm coming this way is because there's evidence of another military storage depot. And you start to see that. I'm already starting to see bits of loose brick around, and I'll overlay that aerial image as well so you can see for yourself. But, you know, there's little bricks on the heath, innocent little bricks, all of which suggest there was some form of structure here at some point. I'll also overlay some photos of some of the road pattern that I've seen, because I think that suggests military purpose. But here you go, look, just under this tree, there was evidently some building to do with the military depot here at some point. And as with so much of the New Forest, nature has started to reclaim what we see. I'm now going to cross the road, because over the road here, there should be two really good examples of bomb craters, according to the New Forest Park survey. So let's go and see if we can find them. So here's the first, and there's meant to be another one around here as well. So yeah, you can see the deep impression in the ground. Oh look, there's even some more of that old roadway stuff. So it would appear that at the point the depot by the side of this road was destroyed, maybe whoever destroyed it just flung some of the brickwork out here. But yeah, look, there's another bomb crater. We can go down into it. Here we are in a bomb crater, and there should be, I think, another one over here. So let's have a quick look. More bricks. Hang on, what's behind this bush? I've got a feeling we might be nearly on top of it. Yeah, I think this is probably it. See, it's a big depression in the ground. Another bomb crater. So why are there so many around here though? I'm gonna sit down and I'll take you through my theories. This is probably a good place to sit. There's a number of reasons. So firstly, there was a lot of activity in this area during the war. We've seen those two old storage depots, potentially they were targets. Secondly, we're near the railway line, so perhaps the enemy wanted to destroy some of the travel and rail infrastructure. The other one is that the yew tree heavy anti-aircraft position is over that way, and we'll be going there soon. What better target for enemy bombers to try and take out? And who's to say they weren't always that accurate? So it's not unreasonable to think that we're sat in a bomb crater right now that could have been targeting that. The other reason would be, I've seen aerial photography from the 1940s, and you can clearly see what look like bomb craters. They don't look like anything else. And lastly, and this is kind of anecdotal, I've heard that when enemy bombers were returning from bombing raids in England, this would have been their flight path. Germans would have been based in France at some point. If they still had bombs they'd not used, they'd want to go faster, so perhaps they would have jettisoned some unused bombs and that would have let them get a quicker getaway. Or anecdotally again, the other one I've heard is that when the Allied bombers were returning here, and bear in mind that all these airfields around here, particularly RAF Beauly, not too far away, if they still had live and unused bombs, they might have dropped them on the New Forest in a safe area, possibly like this. Now, again, that's purely anecdotal, but it's interesting, isn't it? Because I'm sat in a bomb crater now, and what's a very peaceful location, but there was some point in history where this place was far from peaceful. This place here is called the Beauly Road Pony Sales. It's a really old tradition, and what it does, once a year, the commoners who own all the horses out in the New Forest that you'll be familiar with, they bring them here. The horses have their health checks, and then the commoners can buy, sell, and trade horses between each other for the coming year. And such is the tradition at this place that all the trading is actually done with guineas rather than pounds. So that is what this place is. Like I said, nothing to do with World War II. Just a really, really interesting sight to see. I'm just walking away from the car park now. I'm gonna head up the hill through these woods up to Yew Tree Heath. But these woods also have something that relates to World War II. So they say that there are slit trenches around here somewhere. The whole of the New Forest was in effect a massive training camp for the troops, especially in that lead up to D-Day. So the fact that they're could be slit trenches in here that they're used for training, isn't it at all surprising? Just quickly, I'm just literally on the way to Yew Tree when I spied this. So that to me looks like it could have been one of those slit trenches for practice reasons. You can imagine it, can't you? They were practicing and training, possibly here too. But it really is quite hard to say where nature's taken over. So I think now's a good time to do the last part of today's journey, which is to walk up to the HAA battery, the heavy anti-aircraft battery at Yew Tree Heath. So to do that, come out of these woods, and there's a path that runs from the car park all the way up to there, and then we're gonna eventually turn right. So I've just walked up from the car park and the woods down there up this road, and I've decided I'm actually gonna change my route today. As I said, I've not done this before, or the Yew Tree part at least. Two reasons why I'm thinking about changing my route. Firstly, I think this road leads to a farm, and I'm not 100% sure if it's a private road or not. It wasn't particularly clearly labelled when I came through the wooded part, so it wasn't immediately obvious. But probably the more important thing, I would say, is this, because I was going to walk along this heathland track to get to the yew tree position. But at the moment, there's rare birds nesting here. It says, please consider another route. Now, when you come on walks like this, we always have to respect the wildlife. It's their home more than ours, okay? So I'm gonna walk back down. I'm gonna just have a quick drink at the car. And then what I'm gonna do instead is walk along the road. It's kind of back the way I came, and come into the and walk into the yew tree heath car park. I think there'll still be one of those red signs, but if I do that, I won't have to walk across any heathland. And just boils down to doing the right thing, doesn't it? So that's what I'm gonna do. So I'm a bit puffed out. We've walked all the way from there to get to the yew tree heath car park. Now again, they do have the rare birds nesting sign. The car park is closed, so this sign won't be like this forever, but whilst it is here, we need to respect it. But what it does say, it says, if you walk beyond this point, just keep to the main tracks. Just gonna protect the birdies. We're not gonna go anywhere other than this concrete track. But look, you can already see evidence of where buildings would have been here. We'll carry on going. Now, the interesting thing is, down here is just the technology that they were using at the time in terms of things like range finders and estimating tools to make sure they hit the aircraft. I'll overlay some vintage videos. You can kind of see how it might work. And I'm now in the car park. So when it's not the bird nesting season, people obviously come and park in here and then walk out into the heathland. And as I said, I'm not going to do that myself, but I think there's an opportunity here just to stand on part of what would have been the anti-aircraft position. So we can come up here. We can see the old concrete structure that's been buried, destroyed and filled in at some point. Very ununiform parts of the land here. Look, here's some more of it. So, and the reason this place was chosen is its position. It's high up. It probably offered a great defence of places like the Southampton docks, possibly the airfields. So any of those German planes coming over, they would have had this gun position to deal with. And here's some more evidence of it here. Now, I'm not an expert at all at this place, but what I do know is that a lot of the gun positions, I think they were in groups of three or four, they were dug into the ground for protection, and in those circles in the ground, there were little arms stores and whatnot in there. But again, I'll overlay some photos and I'll show you some vintage video. Hope you've enjoyed the walk. Hope it's given you some inspiration as well. Everybody needs to be out in the forest at the moment, what with all the things that have happened over the last year. So I hope you can get out and enjoy yourself too. I'm going to head back out of the car park and walk back along that road, and might come back once the bird nesting season is over so I can have a nice walk across that heathland. But yeah, hope to see you soon, guys. Thank you.